judgment for every single word that we have spoken. One of these days we all will stand before the Lord and give a reason for everything we've done. And what I've done is trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God.
Okay, before we get started, well, good morning, everyone. We're going to change things around a little bit. We're going to do announcements first and then go into a time of worship. So that's what we're doing. Here's some announcements you need to make mention of today. Back to school. Don't forget that it's the Operation Christmas Child is going through back to school items. The reading update. You know what it is? Do you know what it is? Do you know what it is? Do you know what it is? All right. It's First Hesitations chapter 3 and 4. All right. All right. Fellowship dinner today after church. If you want to stick around, we're going to have a wonderful meal downstairs. High school upper room, a game and movie night, which is PJ night, appropriate PJs. Don't wear the ones you got on your birthday. Okay, I'll just keep going here. Hope is here. September 19th is Come Back to Church Sunday. If you know of someone that's kind of been missing church and got out of the habit, hey, say, hey, come on back September 19th. We'd love to have you. Come back Sunday. Small group kickoff. I'm going to wait for, he just asked me, are we doing announcements first? And I said, yes, we are. He said, well, I'll be in there. Just take your time. We're trying to cut minutes down. Just take whatever time you got. Don't run. You might break the other arm.
Sorry, I have small children and my wife has me. So, small group kickoff is next Sunday at 4 o'clock. Down in the fellowship hall. If you're interested in joining a small group or starting one, come. We're going old school. We're going ice cream again, okay? So if you make good homemade ice cream, please, please bring it. I like butter pecan. So anyway, please come join us.
Oh, hold on. You got another one coming up.
Okay.
Is she here for this service? There she is over here. Look, she showed up on time. Look at that.
My friend Katrina and I want to invite all the ladies to a praise and worship and prayer hour. We're going to try and do this every month, third Monday, for about an hour, hour and a half. And the first one is at Church of God at 7, and then next month we'll be here. So invite your friends, and hopefully we'll bring other churches along with us. So thank you.
All right. See You at the Pole is going to be September 22nd. This is for the junior high and high school. Whatever school you're at, you need to do that. I think we're also going to do it at the grade school. I need to talk to some of them, and I think even the grade school is going to do See You at the Pole on September 22nd. Marriage night, there you go.
Yeah, hey, marriage night is September 24th. It starts at 6:30. If you want to sign up for that, it's a simulcast. We did it last year. Really good stuff. We will have childcare this year. If you're interested in that, please call the office, talk to Heather, talk to me, and we'll give you the link to sign up. We do have scholarships available for that as well, so don't let that stop you from signing up.
All right. My Story, His Glory is going to be Saturday, September 25th at 7 o'clock. Please come if you know somebody that needs, you'd like to talk to them about Jesus. That's a great opportunity to come to My Story, His Glory. Junior high bowling. Junior high. Are you in junior high? You're not, are you? You're in junior high. You look like you're in junior high. All right, September 25th at Arapahoe. Talk to Evan about that. The Norton Life Chain is October 3rd. We meet here, then we go up to the light, and we stand there for an hour, and we hold some signs, nothing derogatory, nothing mean. We're just, you know, every life is vital, and we pray and read scripture for an hour. So if you'd like to be part of that, all ages, little kids all the way up, all ages, we have everyone take part in that.
Here's a few reasons why people don't go to church.
I can't come to church until I get my life together.
Church is how I got my life together.
Church is filled with a bunch of hypocrites.
And there's always room for one more.
All they care about is your money.
They care about me, not about my money.
Is there some kind of dress code?
Yes, the code is wear some clothes.
Church, it just makes me nervous.
I was nervous at first, and then I felt right at home.
I'm not sure I believe everything that you believe.
But you can still belong.
Church is for wimpy, girly men.
You want to say that again?
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't want me.
If you knew me and what I've done, you wouldn't be worried.
You can come to my church even if you were brought up Catholic,
Baptist,
Methodist,
Jewish,
Mormon,
Lutheran,
Pentecostal,
Presbyterian,
Church of Christ,
Southern Baptist.
A little bit of everything and a whole lot of nothing.
See, it's not about a religion, it's about a relationship.
So please, come to my church.
Where nobody's perfect.
Where beginners are welcome.
Where socks are optional,
but grace is required.
Where forgiveness is offered.
Where hope is alive.
And where it's okay to not be okay. Really.
So welcome. Let's stand. This is big day for us. These are a lot of new songs, so I hope you love them like we do. And if you know them better than us, lead the way. But anyway, thank you for coming.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. Coming around, in no way you'll ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down.
God Almighty,
I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. 'Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the noontime, Jesus when the sun goes down.
All right, good morning.
All right. Woo. You guys did pretty good.
We'll do that again.
Why search the world? It couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied. Here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn graves into
Amen. So we're going to do a song about what we believe. It's the Creed.
God in heaven, you are so good to us. We give you praise and thanks this morning for getting us here and getting us into this communion and this fellowship with our brothers and sisters. God, that we might be one in this place. Heavenly Father, we invite you into our hearts and into this place, God, that you would do a work in us, God, to show us that you are Lord, to change our hearts from the inside out. God, we give you thanks and praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all the stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news. Tell you about my Jesus, and let my Jesus change your life.
Yeah, we're there now. Okay. There's some energy in here this morning. Great worship. I'm going to start off with something really light and breezy. What's wrong with the world? People started to answer that. Don't do that. Rhetorical question. But, you know, in all seriousness, we're all wrestling with that right now. It's a complicated environment that we're living in. And it's raising a lot of issues. But I just want to point out some statistics about the last year and a half that we've seen in our country. It's kind of what I do. I'm kind of a stats guy. So let me just read a few of these to you. And they're not pleasant statistics. We've seen a 20 to 50% increase in the number of people drinking excessively or using drugs since COVID began. There's been a 41% increase in heavy drinking by women. That's a lot more than men, and you can think about why that might be the case. Tragically, in the United States over the past year, we saw the greatest number of overdose deaths in our recorded history, and it wasn't even close. There are severe labor shortages across our country and in many industries, but especially in healthcare, the field that I work in. Sadly, we are seeing 1,000 people a day dying due to COVID-related illnesses. And I believe we lost two more just in our county over the past week or two. Since COVID began, the number of people in our nation reporting symptoms of depression and anxiety disorders has quadrupled. It's quadrupled. And that number is even higher for healthcare workers. 8% of Americans considered suicide at the height of COVID. Triple that number for healthcare workers. But this is not just a COVID thing. All these issues were always significant in the world. COVID just amplified many of them. Overdose deaths, drug use, increases in depression, anxiety, suicidality, were all a very real reality well before COVID started. How did we get here? What's the source of all of this? And what's the answer? You know, as we think about this, we might think about society's the problem. It's our society that's led us to where we are today. Maybe some of us might answer, it's our educational system. It's let us down. It's not educating our children properly. And some of us might say, well, we can't point our fingers there. It's our families and our parenting. We haven't done the job we should have in raising our kids. Some might say it's the judicial system or the criminal justice system. We're too strict on people. We're too lenient. Some might say it's the medical field. They haven't created the proper medications we need to heal people or the treatment that is needed. And maybe in a more thorny issue, we might say it's the government's fault. The policies and laws that they've laid out has not led us down a pathway of peace. And depending on whose social media account you look at, it's the fault of the Democrats or the Republicans. Certainly, there's some truth to all these factors that have led to our modern day troubles. You know, this question, what's wrong with the world, was asked over 100 years ago by the London Times. In 1908, they sent out a question to some of the most notable intellects and scholars in England, and they asked that very question, what's wrong with the world? As you can imagine, they got lots and lots of essays that were long-winded and waxed eloquently about the problems in society and why we are where we are. But one response caught my attention, a response by a man named G.K. Chesterton. C.S. Lewis said he thought he was the greatest apologist of his age. And he responded to that to the London Times, and he said this, "Dear sirs, regarding your article, What is Wrong with the World? I am. Yours truly, G.K. Chesterton." What is wrong with the world? I am. Yours truly, in this case, would be Patrick Hall. What did Chesterton mean by that? He was making the point that maybe our greatest problem is not first and foremost a social issue, a political issue, or an ideological issue, but a spiritual one. One that begins in here and not out there. As Timothy Keller said, Chesterton's response is the attitude of someone who has fully grasped the message of Christ. You see, Chesterton took to heart the words of Paul, what he said to Timothy. Here's a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. Chesterton was given the opportunity to point his finger of blame at anyone, to address any issue he felt was pressing on his society, to speak to the sin that plagued his culture, but he chose to humbly and directly address the problems of his own heart. No doubt there's a time and place for pointing out sin. There are circumstances where we as Christians must stand up boldly to proclaim the gospel to the world. But biblically, the first place we need to start is with ourselves. Jesus has said many things about the ills and problems of the world, but ultimately, Jesus didn't come to the world to save us from depression or drug use or from any ideology or political party. But first and foremost, he came to save us from ourselves. In the end, he said the greatest problem of all is the problem of our own heart. And the only way to solve that problem was for him to give his life and for us to relinquish ours. Then, and only then, does the pathway to righteousness and peace become clear. We should wake up each morning with David's prayers on our lips. Lord, create in me a clean heart, O God, and give me the right spirit. As we think about the problems of our world today, and as we prepare for communion this morning, let us look inward and remember Jesus and the sacrifice that he made to overcome the greatest problem of all, the sin within your heart and within mine. Let's pray. Father God, we confess that we live in a world that's hard to make sense of. We deal with issues that we might not completely be able to wrap our minds around. But we're grateful that in the end of the day, you gave your son for us. And that we could come to you with confession and search in our own hearts for it to be renewed. Lord, how we need that today. Renew in us a clean heart and give us the right spirit. Thank you for the sacrifice that you made so that we can learn how to do that. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Will you pray with me over the tithes and offerings? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the sunshine and just a great message from Patrick. It's where our hearts should be with you, Lord. And please accept our offerings and our tithes as we give part of our earnings and our talents back to you to go out and further your kingdom in this world. We ask all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Kids' Quest and extended session. Well, I was told Patrick in the first service how that I want you to know that Patrick and I didn't talk this week at all, and a lot of his meditation goes with the sermon this morning. I said, that's kind of eerie when you're listening to this. It's kind of like that eerie feeling you get that maybe I didn't have anything to do with this at all, that God's in charge of this and has something for us that we need to listen to. And in 1 Corinthians, it was written during 55 AD. This is Paul's third missionary journey. He's probably in Ephesus when he writes this, and he's found out that there's some problems going on in the Corinthian churches, and what he does, he has five different problems that he addresses in this letter. And what you're going to see is the idea that unity is key for the believers. We had our 101 class, and one of the things that we remind our people from our church is, in essentials, things that's in the Bible, we have unity on it. In matters of opinion, well, you leave it up to everyone's discretion. And the thing you can't do is preach opinion. And too many people try to preach their opinion from the pulpit, and it doesn't save anybody. When I was a kid, a preacher friend of mine called that rabbit track theology. And so often, preachers get on these rabbit tracks, and they try to preach a rabbit track, and they're missing the heart of the whole reason why we're gathered. And this theme through the whole book of 1 Corinthians is the idea of unity through holiness, and holiness can be found in Christ Jesus. And how that since we're trying to get along with other people, that sometimes what we have to do is be able to put up with people's opinions. When I was a kid, now, how many of you have a sibling? Okay. How many of you have ever heard this phrase somehow said from your parents? And I'm going to start it, you finish it. Can't we just all... Right. And what's the answer? Okay. My dad said it's yes or else. I didn't know the answer was going to be no on that. I guess I can quit now. But no, it is hard to get along. And we as the church, if there's anything the world needs to see, is a church that loves each other. Is a community of believers that knows how to have differences and get along. And that's the whole idea of 1 Corinthians. The key word in this is Jesus. He is mentioned 24 times in 16 chapters. 24 times in 437 verses, Jesus is mentioned. In the first section, from 1 Corinthians 1 to chapter 4, he is mentioned 13 times. In chapter 1, in 10 verses, he is mentioned 8 times. In chapter 1, he is mentioned 9 times. The key to getting along is that we are in Christ Jesus. We have unity because we agree in Christ. And the key verses is verse 1, verse 10. Now I exhort you, brothers, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you are made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment. Does that mean then we all have to agree on everything? No, it means that we got to learn how to disagree and still be agreeable. Something that America has lost is the fact that we can have a conversation, I disagree on the conversation, and still walk away as brothers and sisters or brothers and brothers in Christ. We've got to learn how to be disagree without being disagreeable. And there are some people in this world that if you're for it, they're against it. Why? Because you're for it. And that's the only reason. They just love to argue. There are people in this world that just love to argue. The trouble is there are people in churches today that just love reason to argue with somebody. Here are the five sections in this book, and I'll get these slowly later. The first section is divisions, talking about how that there's people that are separating, and the reasons why they're separating is crazy. The next section is sex. I said it. I didn't want to say it too loud, you know. But the S word is the next section. It's what it's about. Paul just brings it right up. The thing is, when Paul writes 1 Corinthians, he doesn't run around the question. He doesn't run around the topic. And you don't walk away going, I wonder what he believes. He tells you exactly what he believes on it. And here it is right out there. And that's number two, is that one. Number three is food. And it's not what you like or dislike, but it's food that was sacrificed to idols. Should we eat it or not? Number four, the fourth division, is the gathering itself. People were coming together in worship, and the worship itself was causing division. Can you believe that? Well, they didn't like this, or they didn't like that. They thought it all should be over here. We should be doing all this or doing all that, and there was division about it. The fifth reason is the resurrection. Some of them in the church didn't know what to believe. And so they decided that, well, it doesn't matter what you believe. Everything is okay. That's not true. And the final thing that we see in Corinthians is the final greeting. And here's the first part about this that I love so much is, in each one of these, what Paul does, he first gives you, defines the problem. Here's what the problem is. The second part is he goes to the Word of God and says, in the Word of God, in Jesus, the gospel, Jesus' story of his life, death, burial, and resurrection, here's where the answer is. And then the third thing he does, you see here, you're not living to the answer. Here's the problem. Here's what Jesus says about it or lived about it. And then here's how you're not living to the answer of that problem. That's how we need to dissolve problems today. And here's the first part of this, is divisions. Here's what he says. Now I exhort you, brethren, by the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree and that be made no divisions among you, but you are made complete in the same mind and in the same judgment. For I have been informed concerning you, my brothers, by Cleo's people, that there are quarrels among you. Now what I mean is this, each of you are saying, I am Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, that's also Peter, or I follow Christ. Has Christ been divided? Paul was not crucified for you, was he? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I didn't baptize any of you except for Crispus and Gaius, or so that no one could say that they were baptized into my name. Now I did believe or baptize also the household of Stephanus. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anybody. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not in cleverness of speech, so that the cross of Christ would not be made void. For the word of the cross is foolishness for those who are perishing, but for those who are being saved, it is the power of God. You see, there's divisions in what was going on and what happened in Corinthians, in Corinth. What was going on? There was at least 12 other temples. And what they did in these other temples, I like this guy's philosophy, and he's smarter than your guy. And they started following after certain people, and that's what they were doing. They liked different philosophies. And this church was doing the same thing. They were going, well, I'm following what Paul says, or I'm following what this person says. And he's saying, we didn't divide. We're preaching the same gospel. And I can tell you, there are preachers that I like to listen to. There's preachers that I've got copies of their tapes. Some tapes, in my day, a tape was, you put in a little tape cassette. A tape cassette, okay, anyway, I'll move over here to the older people. They know it. You know tape. All right. I have tapes of these people. These guys have been dead since the 80s. And some of them I like to listen to. They don't even have tapes for them. They just write, they've been dead since the 1880s. Great preachers. And every once in a while, somebody would give me a book or, hey, you got to listen to this guy. They give me a new form. What do they call that where it's already online and you just go to it and listen to it? And they got a bunch of them and streaming, yeah, that stuff. They give me those things. I'm still stuck in the old days. I'd rather get a tape. I can rewind it better. Some of them they give me too. Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's okay. He's not my cup of tea. Do you know there are people that don't go to church when the preacher don't show up? I'm glad you guys aren't like that. I found out talking to Garrett Rowland, he says, no, actually, when you leave, the attendance goes up. So that bothered me a little bit, you know. But there's divisions, and there should be no divisions. And he's not talking about baptism here. I've heard people use this as, well, he's talking about the baptism's not essential. No. What he was saying was, I didn't come to make disciples, did I? I don't have disciples of me. Only two people come to make disciples, John and Jesus. And John said, I must become less so that he must become more. Jesus came, and we're supposed to follow him, be disciples of Jesus Christ. Because later on, Paul says, follow me as I follow Christ. Divisions. It saddens me that we've allowed some of the dumbest things to divide us. Why'd you quit going to church? Why'd you stop attending? You can answer that for other people. And you ask, that is some silly reasons. Divisions in the church is something that shouldn't happen. When the world sees a church divided, they don't see our strength. Our strength comes in the fact that we can disagree on things and we can still break bread together. We can have opinions, and there are opinions, and we can laugh about it and carry on about it. But you know what? That's an opinion. We can discuss these opinions and discuss them in a way that when we're done, we're still brothers and sisters, or brothers and brothers, or sisters and sisters in Christ. We didn't allow this opinion to separate us. We have churches back when I was growing up separated over writing on the wall. That's what they called this. You need a hymn book. It's in the Bible. You got to sing songs out of a hymn book. And you got to sing psalms. You got to sing hymns. Jesus didn't write that Psalms 9 and stuff. That's not in the Bible. It's called Psalms 9, sir. Things like crazy things that we've allowed to divide us, that should not be. It should be a matter of opinion, and you should be able to worship God. And when you come here, the whole intent is to worship God and to give yourself to Him, to surrender to Him. The next part. This is what he talks about. And what was going on in this section, and what he was talking about, was they were doing things that was not what the Bible said was okay. In some of these other temples, the way they worshiped in these other temples, these other gods, they actually had what they called prostitutes, temple prostitutes, and part of the worship was to go do stuff with these prostitutes. And these people that were coming to church were doing these activities outside the church. And the church says, well, it's okay, because you see, grace is a bottomless pit. No matter what you do, you're okay. As long as you believe that Jesus is Christ, you can go out and do whatever you want to do because you're covered. You know, that's not found in Scripture. What's found in Scripture is that I accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And Lord means He owns me, and my life needs to reflect the guy that owns me. And there's coming a day that it's going to matter what I did in the body, and the Bible says that I will be judged for what I did in the flesh. So my behavior in the flesh, I said I believe Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of my life. Did I live like it? And he pinpointed this because this was a major issue during this time. But you can do it with any sin that was going on. Here, listen to what he says. It is actually reported, listen to that word, it is actually reported that this stumbled Paul. I cannot believe this is reported, that there is sexual immorality among you. For what kinds even the pagans would not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife, a stepmother, and you are proud of this. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out the person out of fellowship, this man who had done these things? Well, doesn't the Bible say thou shalt not judge? You can't judge me for what I'm doing. Don't judge me. There's a reason why there's a statue, and there's a reason why there's limitations. There's a reason why God does these things. He wants us to live a good life. And when we live the life in His realm and in these guidelines, you're going to live a good life. No matter what happens in this world, you're going to be able to be content. And being able to be content in this life is a good life. Well, we can't judge. Well, let me go ahead and read what he says next. For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit, As one who is present with you in this way, I have already passed judgment in the name of the Lord Jesus on the one who has been doing this. So what did Paul just say about what we need to do with sin in the church? Don't laugh about it. Don't condone it. Deal with it. Because we are the representation of the body of Christ. And what they say we are allowing, they're saying that that's what we condone. And it's what we need to be doing is we need to be showing love and grace and peace with other people. And the way we do that is when somebody is doing this, we don't go at them pointing our finger at them. We go at them concerned with their future. Not only their future of heaven, but their future here and now. You're living a destructive life. We can put in anything else in there. Why are we so adamant about trying to get people clean from drugs and alcohol? Because we know what happens at the end of this road. It's not that I'm trying to judge them so that they go, you know, you're going to go to hell and I like it. No, it's that if you do not change the way you're living, not only is that, but you're going to lose your family. Do you really want your kids to date somebody like you? I had a good friend of mine, man, I love this man. He wouldn't mind me telling you this. His name was Bucky. Man, you couldn't ask for a better-hearted, fun-loving. The guy was great. One day while I was preaching in church, at the last church I was in, Jay was just a baby, still in diapers, and Bucky was running the nursery. And he got tired and wanted to go home because I guess the Rams or somebody was playing. So he stripped Jay down to his diaper and ran him down the middle of the church, right to me. When everyone sees that, they start laughing. Church was over. I love Bucky. He's hilarious. Aggravated me sometimes, but he was hilarious. When his wife was at home having contractions, he had the car getting drunk at a bar. And I had to go chase him around trying to find where the car is because her purse was in the car, their medical insurance was in there, everything they needed, and I had to go do that. When I finally found him, I was so mad because I couldn't convince him that it was time to go home for his wife that I literally almost started a bar fight and I was sober. He came in to the office the next week and he was saying, this is why I drink and she's why I drink and her mom this and this and that. And I just looked at him and I said, Bucky, you have two little kids. Would you want your daughter to drag somebody home that's like you? That was the end of the discussion. We've got to live a life that is in line with what the Word of God says. And Bucky took it serious, and he went to dry out. And I was the one that drove him to rehab, 8 hours out of my way. I'm not doing that to brag on my back. What do I got to do to help you? Because I want you to have a good life. The whole time we're driving, his dad's in the back seat crying the whole way because he knew it was a generational thing. And his son is that away because he was that away. And he was crying the whole way. But that was several years ago. Bucky now is one of the leaders of the Celebrate Recovery group. Dragging other people and says, I can't believe that's what I used to be. He's taking charge. You see, we don't do these things because we're trying to point our fingers at people. We know what the future of that lifestyle is going to lead to. It's destruction. That's why we say you've got to change the way you're living. That's why you want to have God to bless your relationship. Have a relationship that God says, this is what I'll bless. If you're doing something wrong in your life, this is what you do. So I don't want to do something that's going to bring distraction or tear me down. I want to do something that's going to lift me up and encourage me. The third one's on food, and this one, you know, is very strange. And what was happening, there's actually a division between the Jews and the non-Jewish Christians. The Jews couldn't eat meat that was sacrificed to idols. In these other temples, they were sacrificing animals, and then they would sell that meat cheaper. And the Gentiles were going, it's just cheaper meat. I have no problem with it. The Jews were going, I can't eat that because it was meat sacrificed to an idol. And so Paul says this. Don't make this a matter of division. Don't make this a matter of argument. You are free to do whatever you want to do, but don't use your freedom to destroy somebody else. Look at 1 Corinthians 9:9. Be very careful, however, that you exercise of your rights does not become a stumbling block for somebody who's weaker. And in this situation, the Jews were the weaker ones. They didn't have the freedom. And they can't do it. And he says, if you know that you're inviting somebody over that has a problem with this, and you stick that meat out there, and you know they have a problem with it, you're causing them to sin because of sin of the conscience. There are several things in the Bible that says it's against my conscience. Maybe not against yours, but it's against mine, so I can't do it. You know, I don't drink, but I'm not going to stand up here and say, thou shalt not drink. I can show you in the Bible where it's led a lot of people to some bad places. In 20-plus years of ministry, I can't tell you how many times an occasional drink has caused a divorce or has caused kids to do this or that. Well, Daddy did it, so I'm going to do it. I've seen it. So I just choose my choice, my opinion. It's my choice. I'm not going to make it a matter of argument. But if I come over and, hey, Nate, you want a cold one? No, I don't. Maybe I'm the weaker one in this situation. That's okay. I'll do that. You won't see me if it's a bar, you know, and that's what it's for. I have a personal problem going there to eat. It's me. But it's my opinion. I'm not going to stand up here and say, thou shalt not go down to wherever it's at and eat. I'm not going to do that. It's my opinion. And the way I'm going to live my life is through that opinion. I and Brent were talking one time, and I got disgusted because a boy died. It was a drunk thing. He got over intoxicated and he died. And I told Brent, I said, I want to just love to get you guys some of the nastiest alcohol out there and have you try it just so you won't ever drink. And he said, I would rather have the stuff never touch my lips. Man, I'd love for him to be 48 years old and know that it's never touched his lips. That would be great. Matter of opinion. Can anybody for bonus points, all the money in my front right pocket right here, this big wad of money here. Okay, I got a pen. Can anybody tell me what 1 Corinthians 10:13 says? Without cheating, Carolyn. No temptation has seized you that is not common to man. But when you are tempted, you have a God that has given you a way of escape. Amen. He is dealing with the temptations that come along with being a Christian and these things that's going to make you go backwards. The temptation of, you know, it's my right. No temptation has seized you. People use this out of context a lot of times. They say, well, God won't give us more than we can handle. You know, 1 Corinthians 10:13. He's talking about temptations. He won't give you more than you can handle. Go ask the Afghan Christians if that's true. He's talking about temptation. You're not going to be tempted beyond what you can bear, and that way of escape is Jesus Christ. And when you're wondering, well, it's my right to eat this food, it's my right to do this, you know what? No temptation. The key to this section is the word love, and we're going to get into the next section, because the next section is about the gathering, and its gathering is chapters 11 through 14. In the middle of this section is 1 Corinthians 13. For this pen, can somebody on this row and on that row tell me what 1 Corinthians 13 is known as? Cheaters. The love chapter. I'm keeping my pen, you cheated. The love chapter. In the gathering, what was happening? Some of these people gathered. They wanted a great spiritual experience. And they were drawing attention to themselves. They were bragging about their spiritual gifts. Well, I got the gift of tongues. Well, I got the gift of healing. Well, I got the gift of prophecy. He says, it's not given to you to brag, but to lift up the church. That's another key to this section. Everything we do should edify and lift up the church. Edification, the gathering. Man, what have we divided over? I love what he said about COVID. Man, we have allowed this thing to become such a ripping of the church. And we don't let it stay, you do your research, I'll do my research. We've on both sides, have taken scriptures out of context to back our opinion. What you need to say is, I've read, I've prayed, and this is what I feel I should do with my family. If you want to get the shot, you know what? Knock yourself out. Get six of them, whatever it takes. But if you feel, hey, you know, I'm not there yet. And I don't have an opinion on this yet. I'm reading both sides of the aisle. Right now, you know, people say, what's your public stance? My public stance is, you do what you feel is best for you and your family. And leave it alone. I've had people tell me from the pulpit, I need to push a certain agenda. I'm not doing that. You do what you feel is best for you and your family on that. But don't make it a matter of dividing the church. There's other issues that we've made contrition on, and we shouldn't do that. In this section, he says, you know, everything needs to be done in unity and order, and everything needs to be done out of love. We come together. When people see us as a brothers and families in Christ, one of the things, man, I felt love when I was there. I feel like I'm a brother. I feel like they got my back. When I go in there, they're worried about what's going to happen to my life, and they're concerned with me, and I love that. I feel like I can tell them anything, and it's going to be left just that. I can tell them. I pour out my soul. Listen to the key to this section. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there is tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, they will pass away. These are the spiritual gifts that was given to the first century church. He said there's going to be a time that these things are going to do away with. Don't get caught up in these things. Then he ends by this, and now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love. This love is a spiritual gift. They were getting caught up in this and that, and Paul says, not all speak in tongues, do they? Not all prophesy, do they? Not all do these healings. Each one was been given to edify and lift up the church. That's one of our responsibilities, is to edify. When you come here, you need to feel encouraged. The last thing they had a problem with was the resurrection. And I tell you what, I love the way Paul handles this. This is one of my most exciting passages of Scripture in the whole Bible, 1 Corinthians 15. He goes through there and says, some of you don't know if we have the resurrection or not. And you say it's no big deal. It is a big deal. Because if Christ didn't rise from the grave, we need to be pitied among all people. Just go home and die, because there's no need to follow him. Because if he didn't rise from the grave, then we're not saved from our sins. If he didn't rise from the grave, we have no hope. There's no reason why we're facing persecution. If he didn't rise from the grave, there's nothing to look forward to. You know, I look forward to potlucks. I really look forward to potlucks. Brant about moved back to Illinois because he says, you know what, you've allowed this COVID to stop potlucks. That's a sin. A year ago, he was, hey, you're supposed to have one once a month, Dad. I came here, and one of the reasons why I was willing to come out here was that they said they had a potluck once a month. We ain't had that potluck. And you know how Mom don't like to cook? She's good at it. She just don't like to do it. And the only time I get to eat is once a month when we have a potluck. Now, either you be the church and have a potluck, or I'm going home. Was that kind of what you said? Somewhat. I mean, it was somewhat what he said. I look forward to potlucks. You know why I look forward to potlucks? Because you can put stuff together that makes no sense. You got cooked cabbage and peach cobbler. I mean, on the same plate. Doesn't make any sense, but you know what? You can do it at a potluck. I love coming together. I look forward to them. I look forward to the laughing and having how Brad Cox, wherever Brad Cox picks first to go, I'm usually sitting on the wrong spot. And I found out he's always looking for certain people. And where certain people are sitting, I've decided I'm not sitting next to them because they always go last. Right? That's true. Preach it, right? Yeah. Man, we should look forward to the resurrection. Do you realize that here in April, we're going to celebrate Easter? We're going to celebrate the welcome home party of our loved ones. We're going to celebrate today that we shuck, that's a term, shuck this body for our heavenly body. We're going to celebrate today that it's worth it. It's worth it. It's worth it because we get to this day. I love how he puts it this way. Listen to this. But when the perishable will put off imperishable and the mortal will have put on immortality, then the saying will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O grave, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But he doesn't stop there. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, because then you know your labor is not in vain. We have something to look forward to. If you're living the life that Jesus has called you to live, if you're dealing with the sin, if you're trying to get along with your fellow man, if you're doing these things, there's going to be a day that you're going to hear, well done, by the person who it matters by. You're going to go into heaven, and there's going to be a great cloud standing there, and they're going to applaud your entrance because you stayed fast and you stayed true, because you knew there's a reason to stay to the Scriptures. And what 1 Corinthians is telling us to do is to look at our whole life through the eyes of the gospel. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, And his final greeting, I love this part. Finally, tell these people hello and do this to these people, and I'm going to come and I'm going to get some money when I come and I'm going to do these things. But he says this, look at verse 13. If you get nothing else, be on the alert. Why? Because Satan wants to destroy you. Wednesday night in our elders meeting, one of the things we talked about as elders and leaders of the church, if he gets us, he's got the church. He's on a rampage to get the leaders. So when you sign up in a couple weeks, we're voting on elders and deacons. He's coming after you. You put your name down and you do that, he's coming after you and your family. Are you ready? Be on the alert. Stand firm in the faith on Jesus Christ. Act like men. Wow, in 2021, can you actually say that and not make somebody mad at you? Isn't it toxic masculinity? Act like men. What's he saying? It's the man's job to be the defender of the home. Part of the man's job in the Hebrew language was the idea that you're a warrior and you say, not in my house, or this is what we're going to do. As for me and my house, we'll do this. You be the warrior. Act like men. When Satan's coming to you, you say, you what? Come. But you ain't gonna like what you find. Act like men. Be strong. Let everything you do be done in love. Let me ask you this. How confident today is your walk with Jesus Christ? Are you confident? Do you believe that he's broke the power over death in your life? Do you believe he's broke the power over sin in your life? The real question, what is holding you back from being who Jesus wants you to be? You see, when you're looking at 1 Corinthians, it's an internal look. Am I living the life that God has asked me to live? Am I making excuses for my behavior because, you know, grace is a bottomless pit, so I don't have to worry about it because I'm covered by the grace? Or is he telling us, look inside yourself. He gives us the Holy Spirit. What is it in your life? Is it a sin that you're hanging on to? You know what? This is a good time to get rid of that. Maybe he's asking you to step forward to do something. Step into something. You know, we're getting ready to do small groups. Next week, we're doing a small group kickoff. Maybe he's telling you, you know what? You need to start a small group. We had two ladies come to us and say, you know what? We feel God is calling us to start a ministry. Yeah, they come to the elders, they had a plan laid out, and the elders said, man, let's go for it. Let's do this. We started praying it up, and we want to help people. Maybe God's telling you, this is a ministry I need to start. Let's do this. What's holding you back? What's holding you back? There's a story about a young man who was taking a hike up a mountain. And as he's going up the mountain, he hears this voice, hey, take me along with you. And he's looking around and he finds a snake. And the snake was talking to him and says, hey, take care of me up to the top of the mountain. I can't get up there. And there's a poisonous snake and he says, I can't do that. You'll bite me. The snake says, no, I won't bite you. Trust me. And so after an argument, the boy picks up the snake, carries him up to the top, and as he lays him down, the snake bites him. As the boy's sitting there laying dying, he says, you lied to me. And the snake says, I didn't lie. Because you knew what I was before you picked me up. How many of us are believing Satan's lies? You're okay. Look at that person over there. They're no better off than you are, and you're okay. Just stay where you're at. Well, they can't judge you. They shouldn't. If they're judging you, then they're wrong. Don't believe Satan's lies. Let me just ask you this. Are you allowing God or something else to lead your life? It's invitation time. Why don't you fix the problem now? Let's stand and sing.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Don't forget there's a potluck afterwards, and also don't forget that there's a board meeting if you want to stick around for that. It is what its name implies, so remember for that. Board meeting. So, all right. On your way, grab somebody's hand and say, hey, did you see that the Huskies finally won one? Huskers, finally. Finally. They played a third grade team, but they were able to win. If you're a guest, we'd love to see you in the library. All right. Sing it. Go for it.
Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes, 'cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good?
He's good.
Tell me, is he God?
Have a great week.